since the topic is talking about who is an Indian citizen, I have been writing on NRC, and then I made a video on this in my YouTube series called Legal Awareness Web Series, Who is an Indian Citizen? Believe me, every day I receive about 100 emails. And it is not that most of these mails are coming from Muslims. I receive mails from many, many non-Muslims who are saying that in our high school certificate, the spelling is this, but in our passport, the spelling is this. Will we be included if national NRC is undertaken or not? A state for 5 years is doing nothing except searching documents. And if the whole nation starts doing this document search to prove their existence, then you know where our GDP is going to be. We are already about 5%. The realistic estimate is that it is probably 3.5. It will become maybe 1.5 or 2.5. I don't want to take you to concepts of citizenship, but there are narrower concepts of citizenship and there are broader liberal concepts of citizenship. So our constitution adopted the broader concept. We said anyone who is born on our soil will be our citizen. US also has a similar thing. Many of us, many of you will be the beneficiaries when you go there, and the children will be born there, and if Trump is not there, then they will get citizenship. But this whole idea of citizenship is an idea of exclusion. It is not an idea of inclusion. Citizenship is an idea where we say you are the other. So I define myself with reference to some other. And then I say get lost. You will not get this, you will not get this. The problem with our country is, and in both the cases I am going to demonstrate to you, facts have become irrelevant. How much media has contributed to it? How much political parties have contributed to it? How much we as citizens, by listening to nonsense, have contributed to it? I really don't know. But it has really become so difficult to talk of plain, naked facts. We were told that there are 40 lakh Bangladeshi foreigners, illegal immigrants, 80 lakhs, somebody said 1 crore, another person said 1.2, yet another minister, union minister said 2 crores. At the end of the day, when on 31st of August you got this final NRC, we are told 19 lakhs people are not there. Out of these 19 lakhs, about 4 lakh people are having their refugee certificate. We didn't take them into account. So they will definitely be included now. So 4 lakhs, 4.5 are them. Another 4 lakhs are those who did not apply for NRC. That means they are dead. Then you have a huge majority of Assam's indigenous people. Bengali Hindus are in big majority, around 6 lakhs or so. You have people who are neither speaking Bengali nor speaking Assami, who have been excluded, probably Biharis and UPwalas and other states people who are there. So my rough estimate is that at the end, when all these foreign tribunals with whatever process, they call it judicial process, I call that they are like kangaroo courts with no due process. In fact, their contracts to continue as members of the foreign tribunals depend on how many people they have excluded. So there is a performance sheet which was submitted even to Guwahati High Court, which said, oh, X, the number of people he declared as foreigners is Y, and this is below the expected level, so his contract is not to be renewed. And there are people, members of the Foreigners Tribunal, who declare a lot of people as non-Indians, their contracts are to be renewed. All these people who are members of these Foreigners Tribunals, which were supposed to be the quasi-judicial bodies, many of them are civil servants, retired civil servants. Many of them are lawyers. The original idea of the Foreigners Act. Now, Foreigners Act is not independent India's law. It is a 1946 colonial law. This law deals with people who are foreigners, not with citizens. You do not have any concept of tribunal under the Citizenship Act. Now, when you are an independent constitution, independent country with a constitutional democracy, with liberalism, you can't be dealing with people whose citizenship could not be proved just because there is some discrepancy in a document. And with what state we are dealing? There are people who had faced devastating floods 4 times, 5 times in their life. The entire record has been swept away in the floods. And we are asking them to bring the record. Women are the worst victims because child marriages are still rampant in Assam. Their name could not come in their parents' village's voter list because they were not 21. This 18 voting age will come when Rajiv Gandhi became the Prime Minister, so that is a recent thing. So since they were married when they were not 21, or now and they are still married when they are not 18, this record is not there in the village where they were married. And they are the worst victims. I feel that NRC is a self-inflicted wound. It is a something worse than the partition. If 20th century has seen a man-made disaster on Indian subcontinent because we thought nations are made in the name of religion and created artificial boundaries which proved to be futile because within 25 years or so Bangladesh was created, even though all these Bengalis were Muslims, but they said that we are a different nation. In a constitutional democracy, yet again we have created a man-made disaster where we are asking our own people to prove their citizenship. And we did this propaganda in such a systematic way that the highest court of the country got carried away. And the highest court of the country started behaving as government rather than judiciary. So which document will be accepted, which will not be accepted? Ideally, it should be the function of the executive. Supreme Court itself is deciding. So certificates issued by village head will not be accepted. If a village head has issued a certificate, that village head has to come and testify. Many a times people have received notices from the foreigners' tribunals, 24 hours notice, 48 hours notice, and they are asked to appear 400 kilometers away from their village. These are poor people. They don't have means. And the entire village receives the notice. So many people have committed suicide. In Bengal itself, where there is mere apprehension that an NRC will be implemented, 11 people so far have committed suicide. And when we talk of deportation, how many people are going to be deported? In last 6 years, we have deported only 5 people to Bangladesh. I was reading news. It seems that the Bangladeshi Prime Minister raised up this issue with our Honorable Prime Minister in New York. Of course, there is no official statement from India, but there is a statement from Bangladeshi Foreign Ministry where it seems our Prime Minister has said, don't worry. We are not going to send back these people to you. Our minister is on record, Rajnath Singh, saying we are not sending back anybody. Our foreign minister is on record during his visit to Dhaka. NRC is an internal matter. If it is an internal matter, if we are not going to send these people away from India, why spend about 1500 crores on this exercise? The narrative accepted by the court was this, that these people are in such big numbers, they are influencing our democratic process. They are a burden on our resources. Even if I take entire 19 lakhs who have been excluded, this is less than 4% of your population of Assam. Can 4% people be such a threat to our culture or democratic process that they can adversely affect election results? And once we found out that the results are not to our liking, look at the statement of the minister, Chief Minister himself, Sonowal, who went to the Supreme Court twice on this issue. Look at the minister statement of Himanta Biswas on the day NRC final list was released. When we realized that the reality is different from what we had been convincing people all these years, we said, no, we are going to give them legal aid. Just because somebody's name is not in NRC, that doesn't mean he is not our citizen. In 1997, one fine morning, election commissioner, T.N. Session was there, very powerful election commissioner, did number of good things for our elections. But one thing which was done in Assam was without any inquiry. Some low-level officer, just in front of certain names, he said, doubtful, 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 doubtful. These people became what is now known as D voters, doubtful voters. Their names have not been included. In 2001 or 2, 3 lakh more people were added to this list. Their descendants have also not been included. So you have roughly 4, 5 lakh people who are sons and daughters of these D voters, who are our citizens, who will be eventually included. You have out of 19 lakhs, 2 lakh children. The names of both their parents are in the NRC. Children's name are not there. There are people who have a record of their property dating back to 1924, and their names are not there. People who have served in our army, and their names are not there. Because the whole process itself was faulty. We are overemphasizing 1951 NRC, which was a kind of a census, which was done in few days, without any notice. We are saying that your some relative's name should be there in what they call legacy document, which should be some 1971 document, 1966 voter list, some bank account. I think we need to thank our Prime Minister that because of his initiative, now many of us have bank accounts, but poor people in 66, 71 did not have bank accounts. What percentage of people had bank accounts at that point of time? Then you will have some family tree, and then you need some legatee document, and then connection from this document is to be made to a legacy document. Then only your name will be included. There are lakhs of people whose name is there in the legacy document. I was looking at a case of one person whose father's name was there in the 1966 voter list. His age was written 1966. His age is written 30 years. No, I think in 1951 the age is written 30 years. In 1966 voter list, and of course no citizen has a right to make a voter list. Voter list is made by government officials and it is not made by senior government officials. It is made by lower level officers, of course under the overall supervision of senior officers. This man's age is written 1966. The age should have been written 45, but it is written 95. He is arguing, but it is a clerical mistake. But the name was excluded. Because his father was not accepted as his father. They said it is a projected father. We have made NRC under a law called Section 6A of the Citizenship Act the constitutionality of this law is under challenge. A three-judge bench of Supreme Court has accepted that yes, this is a substantive question of law, whether Section 6A is constitutional or not. And therefore frame not one and two, 13 questions on the constitutionality of Section 6A and referred it to a five-judge constitution bench. Bench had one hearing, then one judge from the bench got retired, superannuated. The bench got dissolved. Don't you think, before we tell people that you are not our citizen, we should be able to have in our hand a Supreme Court order upholding the law under which we are denying people citizenship? Our own Supreme Court doubts the constitutionality of Section 6A. If a three-judge bench does not doubt the constitutionality of 6A, how can it refer it to a five-judge bench? You have to first convince a three-judge bench. Only when three-judge bench is convinced, then only matter goes to a larger bench. What are the questions? Interesting. One of the questions is, a state does not mean mere territory. Here a state means a state of Assam. It also means people and their culture. Since Bangladeshi illegal immigrants are coming to Assam, there is a threat to state, meaning people and culture. And since central government could not stop illegal infiltration, central government is in violation of its duty under Article 355 to protect states from external aggression. Migration is a global phenomenon. America even today has 11 million people who are supposedly illegal migrants. From the times of Aryans, migration is a thing happening. In film Refugee, you had that famous song, ki all these boundaries men have created. This is not for birds who can easily cross boundaries. Is the same definition of a state we are going to apply to Kashmir? That it is not just the territory but also people and culture. And if this is so, how can you decide the bifurcation without taking them on board? Or will you have one definition of a state for Assam and another definition for Kashmir? There is one date for Assam, cut-off date, 24th of March 1971. 25th of March, Bangladesh was born. They say you can't have one date in Assam and another date for other states. As you know, as we stand today, the date for other state is 1st July 1987. So if you have two different laws, then that is unconstitutional. The question is it unconstitutional or not? If court says it is unconstitutional, 5-judge bench, tomorrow decides it is unconstitutional, then entire exercise is to be redone because the cut-off date changes. The law is, you can have one law what to say for one state, one district. What to say of one district, one individual. There can be a law against one individual. Article 14, right to equality, forbids class legislation. It does not prohibit classification. If that one individual is a class in himself, people who are similarly circumstanced will be governed by that one law. We made one law called Motor Vehicle Act. Each state is coming up with its own amendments. The whole question was that under the 1983, this IMDT tribunals, one law was passed to determine the question of citizenship, Illegal Migrants Tribunals Act. This act, in my opinion, rightly said that the burden to prove that X is not our citizen shall be on the state. In entire criminal law, this is how it is. If you accuse that I committed rape, you will prove it. If you say I committed theft, you will prove it. If you say I committed murder, you will prove it. If you say this land is yours, you will prove it. One who alleges must prove is the rule, global rule on evidence. Unless, as I said, that Foreigners Act 1946, pre-colonial. If you arrested me when I was crossing the border, then you can say I should prove that I am an Indian citizen. I am coming back to my mother country. If from my possession you got passport of some other country, then you can say now you prove that you are an Indian citizen, though you are having a passport of some other country. But if someone is born in India, the presumption is to be in favor of that person, and one who alleges that he is not the citizen must prove that he is not the citizen. Against this law and burden of proof, the current Chief Minister of Assam went to Supreme Court. And Supreme Court got carried away by that false narrative of 1 billion infiltrators from Assam, from Bangladesh in Assam, called these infiltrators as vultures, and they struck down this law. Now there is a rule how law is struck down. If there is a law made by Parliament, the thumb rule is that the constitutionality of law is to be presumed by the court. One who again alleges that law is not constitutional must prove that it is not constitutional. That burden was not discharged. The other rule to look at the constitutionality of a law made by Parliament is, ask a simple question. Is the matter on which Parliament has enacted law in the state list? As you know, there are three lists. Union list, on which only Parliament can make law, 97 items are there. State list, 66 items where state can legislate. And there is a third list, concurrent list, on which both center and state can legislate. So if an item is in the state list, then Parliament cannot legislate. So your question should be whether the given item is in the state list. If it is not there, the first test is met. Now you cannot hold that law as unconstitutional unless a second test is there. Whether the law made by Parliament violates fundamental right. You cannot strike down a law if Parliament has jurisdiction to pass that law and that law does not violate any fundamental right. Supreme Court did not follow this route. And rather, imagined an external aggression and struck down Illegal Migrant Determination Tribunal, IMDT. And that is the genesis of today's problem. International law clearly says you can arrest people, keep them in detention if they are foreigners prior to their deportation. So for 3 days, 4 days, 1 month, maximum of 3 months, you may keep them in detention centers. When you have no plan of deporting them, can you keep people in detention for years together? India is a signatory to International Covenant on Civil and Political Rights. We are a signatory to International Convention on Rights of Children. And all these international human rights instruments, they talk of right to nationality. We are in violation of those conventions. Because our court struck down a law unnecessarily. I believe that we should not be guided by false narratives. Otherwise, we will land up ourselves up in this kind of situation. After 1971, experts on migration have been writing, large-scale influx has not happened from Bangladesh. Muslims have not been coming from there after creation of Bangladesh. Hindus have been coming because they feared persecution. In last 10 years, Bangla economy is improving. Do you know what number of Indians are there in Bangladesh? About 10 lakhs. Our people are there, illegally living there. Because Bangla economy is now doing exceedingly well. People who have taken birth on our soil, even if we talk to Bangladesh about deportation, what record Bangladesh will have of them, those people? Most of us, we were not born in hospitals. It is recent phenomena that people take birth in hospitals. Poor people still don't go to hospitals for delivery. Our record keeping is so poor. And if at all we decide citizenship only on the basis of document, I can tell you, you have all kinds of judgments. So somebody had a passport issued by Government of India, and the court said, no, 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 you are not our citizen. So passport as a document was negatived. Somebody had a name in voter list, and we said, no, 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 this we will not recognize. Somebody is having Aadhaar, and we said, no, 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 this we will not. So what is the value of documents? What is the value of documents? Before I stop my discussion on NRC, if we really believe in Akhand Bharat and consider that Bangladesh and Pakistan are part of larger India, I personally feel they are, because as I said that I don't believe nations can be created in the name of religion. And I consider that Pakistan and Bangladesh were wrongly created. Then at least listen to Deen Dayal Upadhyay. Listen to at least Hindu right-wing philosophers who have written, including Deen Dayal Upadhyay, that first we should develop good trade relationship and then have some kind of loose confederation. If we believe, again, I'm picking up from classical Indian ancient civilizational values, Vasudev Kutumbakam. The whole world is a family. How can then, at the end of this exercise, you will have maybe 1.5 lakh, 2 lakh Bangladeshis? You can't keep them. And we are saying we will have NRC in Haryana, we will have NRC in Bengal, NRC in Uttarakhand. What nonsense. Government of India's own population record is saying, I think table 11A or so, that earlier people who were not our citizen, their number was 0.6%. Now it has gone down to 0.4% in last decade. Less than 1% people. What kind of threat they are? Winning election should be the motto of every political party, and I don't mind it. But should we be dividing people, causing such hardship to people? Are we not human? Don't we have any heart? Just because there is some spelling mistake here and some spelling mistake there, we are denying people their citizenship. Citizenship is a right to rights. If you are a citizen, then you have other rights. It is the most crucial right. This right we want to be determined through foreigners' tribunal. 78% of their judgments have been given ex parte. You decided on my back my citizenship. And we want to be Vishwaguru. I think at a time when United States is conceding that space of higher morality, India should have filled that space as a world leader, as a civilizational leader. But we are constructing big detention centers in one state and in another state. I think this is frightening. One Hindu technocrat, IT expert, from Bangalore wrote to me. I cried reading that email. And I'll stop with that email. I don't have the ability to sustain myself. This boy is writing to me that I am into IT, my wife lives in Assam, my parents died in some accident. Somebody in neighborhood adopted me. So I know only that family. I don't know my biological family. And unless you prove your legacy, legatee document, biological link, you can't be included in NRC. I really don't know my family tree. He has written to me that in last 1 year, he wrote number of Facebook posts, on Twitter, I am so-and-so, I am so-and-so. Does anyone know me? Somebody read that post and phoned him. And he was able to locate some distant uncle. He has written to me 5 times he traveled to Assam in last 1 year. through that uncle, he was able to get name of his grandfather, whose name incidentally was there in 1951 NRC. So the link was established. But when final NRC was published, this person's name is not there. Do you think he is concentrating on his work? No. Do you think it will not affect our GDP? It would. It's not a Hindu-Muslim issue. It's a purely constitutional issue, human issue. If you look at how laws have been amended in the last 50 years, we started with this law, anyone born in India will be our citizen. Due to rightist narrative, we brought in a change. We said, no, only people who were born in India till 1st of July 1987 alone will be Indian citizen. So now if you are born after 1987 in India, you don't automatically become Indian citizen, even though your constitution said so. And I was told in my LLB class that constitution is the supreme law of land. Between 1987 to 2003, when we brought in another amendment, we said you will be an Indian citizen if in addition of your birth in India, one of your parents was also Indian citizen. So from soil, birth, we started looking at relationship. Then again we amended our law. And now we say that not only you should be born in India, but either both of your parents should be an Indian citizen, or one of them should be an Indian citizen, and another should not be an illegal migrant. Under what law you can control my right to marry anyone? And if I married somebody who was subsequently, because of some spelling mistake, is found to be an illegal migrant, you want to deny citizenship to my children? Because both their parents will not anymore be Indian citizens. Do you think when fascism will come, it will have a drum in its hand and it would say, oh, I am fascism, I have come. I am fascism, I have come. You have to see the signs. You have to make your own judgment. Constitution of India in Article 51 is imposing a fundamental duty on us to cherish the noble ideals which inspired our freedom struggle. Look at the Motilal Nehru Committee report of 1928. Were we talking of this kind of narrow idea of citizenship? Look at the Karachi resolution. Look at citizenship provisions of our constitution. Entire NRC exercise, in my opinion, is constitutionally suspect and morally pervert. I'll stop here as to my discussion on NRC. There is so much to talk about.